too much in the first 10 minutes, I wouldn't think, would you?
Adoption of the minutes and pledge of allegiance.
Oh, yeah.
Any emails, I suppose.
Yeah, thanks.
Hi, Susan. My name is Nydia Tisdale.
Nydia?
Not Nydia. Just Lydia. Nydia. Start with the letter N.
Nydia.
Nydia.
David, nice to meet you.
If you want to talk, you have to fill in those forms.
You do. Oh, thank you.
And then turn it in to the people up here on the right. In
okay.
The front on the right.
Okay, excuse me.
Structures totaling 3,723 square feet and a future 24,786 square foot permanent worships and housing facility with 111 parking spaces on 9.65 acres currently zoned agricultural district A1. This property is located at 6755, 6765, 6769 and 6775 Dahlonega Highway, Cumming, Georgia 30028. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for James H. Sharp III, CP 130008. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of CP 130008, James H. Sharp III?
I am James H. Sharp III, and I'm here representing Abba House. And Abba House has been in this community since 2000, started ministering to women and children, and this is just an attempt to be able to help more women and children. And we have an immediate need for more classroom space, and that's why the temporary structure. And extensive plans have been submitted to the planning department in relationship to the future expansion. And
thank you, Mr. Shaw. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in support? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing for CP 130008, James H. Sharp III. May I have a second? Seconded by Commissioner Dolezal. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Commissioner Neal, does the board have any questions of Mr. Shaw before we move further? No? Commissioner Neal, this is District 4. Are you, do you have a recommendation?
Yes. I'll make a motion to send CP 130008 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with staff conditions.
That motion was seconded by Commissioner Hoyt. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Shinmaya Mission of Alpharetta Incorporated, CP 140003, has been postponed to May 24th. June 24th, I'm sorry. June 24th. Next is Bastion LLC, CP 140004. Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to operate a commercial horse stable for 16 horses, an existing 6,000 square foot barn, and an existing 14,669 square foot equestrian riding facility with four parking spaces on 5.0 acres, currently zoned agricultural district A1. There's a variance request to remove the required 25-foot rear and side yard setback on the north property line per UDC Chapter 15-1.3, Table 15.2. Also, a variance request to remove the required 25-foot rear and side yard buffer on the north property line per UDC Chapter 15-1.3, Table 15.2. This property is located at 491 Oak Leaf Trail, Suwanee, Georgia, 30024. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for Bastion LLC, CP 140004. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of Bastion LLC, CP 140004?
Madam Chairman, members of the Planning Commission, Stephen Underwood on behalf of Bastion LLC. As stated, we're asking to be able to be granted a conditional use permit to operate a commercial horse stable in South Forsyth County. We will be showing a presentation to see exactly. As stated, the property is owned A1, so a little over 5 acres. If you look to the far right, you see the red commercial area. That is anchored by the Publix grocery store at the intersection of Old Atlanta Road and Sharon Road. And you actually access this property behind the Publix on a small road called Oak Leaf Trail. It goes all the way to the end. You can see in blue that we have a 5-acre tract that has been operated for boarding horses for some time. In fact, it joins the property to the north, which is about 28 acres, which is a commercial stable as well. What we're proposing is to expand this. Bastion operates a world-class dressage center. They will be boarding up to 16 horses on this site. And what has been constructed, as you can see, is a large barn, a riding arena, a covered riding arena, and there's also the operator of the endeavor lives on site in the house. A couple of variances that we had asked for. We're asking to eliminate 25-foot buffer and setback. Whenever you go from a residential agricultural to a commercial use, these pop up and you have these setbacks and buffer. We're asking to eliminate those. Candidly, the contractor who constructed the barn was under the impression that he didn't need his permits to expand the existing building, but you didn't. They understand that. They will pay any penalties that are required for South County. But in order to facilitate the buildings that are up now, we are asking for these two variances along this rear property line you can see in red. We did speak with the adjoining property owners. I didn't see in the crowd. I met with a lady by the name of Cookie Sheetlook. She may be here to speak on her own behalf. But I believe we received a copy of a letter from her attorney. In what we understood, she was comfortable with the variance for the buildings, provided that we made sure that the manure dumpster is at least 100 feet from that building property line. So what we would propose to you is to approve the conditional use permit with this condition, so that it travels with the land, no matter who buys the property on either side. This is a restriction that folks can ask the county to enforce to make sure that the manure dumpsters are located within 100 feet of that building property line. We'll reserve the remainder of our time. We're happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor of this? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition of CP 140004? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Bastion LLC, CP 140004. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Does the board have any questions? Mr. Underwood?
Yes. Mr. Underwood, the variances that you're talking about eliminating, I want to clarify. Are these only as to the structures that were constructed in those setbacks or buffers, and not to include constructing anything else in those?
That's correct. We're happy to commission those variances to the existing structure.
That's my question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Iglesias, this is District 2. Are you prepared to make a motion for a recommendation to send the conditional use permit with variances for Bastion LLC, CP 140004?
I am. Seeing as this is pre-existing and no one is in opposition, I'd like to make a motion to send CP 140004 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with the condition presented by the applicant, as well as the condition that the variances will be to existing structures only.
Second.
That was seconded by Commissioner Floyd. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Public hearings for home occupation permits, there are none. Public hearings for rezonings, 14905 Popewell Roof LLC, ZA 3663, Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A1 to Single Family Residential District Res 3 on 21.73 acres for 54 residential lots with a density of 2.49 units per acre. This property is located on the west side of the intersection of Hopewell Road and Glen Ivy Drive. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for 14905 Hopewell Group LLC, ZA 3663. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of ZA 3663?
Yes, Madam Chairman, I'm Amber Lipscomb. I'm here on behalf of 14905 Hopewell Road LLC. This is a request for a Res 3 zoning district on this almost 22 acres of land there on the north side of Hopewell Road. The request is supported by your staff on the basis that this is shown to be in the suburban living designation on the future development map of the county, and in keeping with the comprehensive plan. And the property is served by public sewer and water. There's a similar Res 3 zoning district immediately to the south on the same side as Hopewell Road. And across the road, there's a conservation subdivision very similar to the property that we were requested to be zoned. Be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to ZA 3663? Could you fill your form out, sir?
Yes.
State your name first, please.
Ron Silverthorne. I stand before you, and I know that this is a good project for the local homeowners on Hopewell Land Drive and Hopewell itself. What I mean by that is I initially received a letter from Emery's law firm back in December of 2013 saying that they wanted to have a public participation meeting to foster community accord, which I went to. Looking at the initial site plan for this neighborhood, two things concerned me living in Hopewell, which is the adjacent neighborhood, is the sewer connection, which on the site plan shown that's going to connect through Hopewell manner somehow, and also the runoff potential pond on the back of the proposed application. When I went to that meeting, they didn't have any clear answers for me of what was going to happen. They didn't know if it was
was actually going to connect in the Hopewell. We didn't know where the water was going to run on the back tension and how that impact would run on the back side of my neighborhood. Had various emails with them trying to get clarification of what was happening. Still do not have clarification on that, although the revised site plan still shows Hopewell Manor as the connection point, with no clear understanding on how they're going to connect in that sewer into the neighborhood without impacting the neighborhood. I do have various emails, including information from Persinger, who I guess is the engineer on the project. And at that meeting back in January, he was saying that, well, I really won't know the complete details until this application is approved. And I, from a federal level, we know that that's a problem when you pass legislation without knowing the details. Also, Holt told me that that most likely the sewer was going to be connected into Glen Ivy manhole A1, but yet the zone, the site plan still shows it's connected into Timberline. So I'm not sure if there's been a why there's disinformation, if it's on purpose or just an oversight. But I asked you guys postpone the application approval today until we get clarification on how the sewer is going to be connected and the impact on the neighbors, Timberline, and Hopewell Manor are advised on how the impact is going to be. So they can attend this next time. I think after this span, 5 months here, there's probably no one even here from my neighborhood because no one knows how it's going to happen. In hope. The fact that initially went to the initial meeting saying it's going to be going in a different direction impacting my neighborhood. So I was asking that you guys, until the details are laid out, provide to the homeowners, not only in Hopewell, but to Glen Ivy, that you postpone this application for more information available.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? Mr. Liston, would you like to have a rebuttal to answer some questions?
Madam Chair, just a second. Let me reset the clock.
Signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes to close the public hearing 5-0. Does the board have any questions? No? Commissioner Neal, this is District 4. Are you prepared to make a motion for a recommendation?
I'd like to send ZA 3663 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with staff, the staff recommended zoning conditions, and the applicant requested zoning conditions accepting number six, and then I have some additional conditions that
Commissioner Neal, before the board moves further, I'd like to point out that the condition number five about the sidewalks, mm-hmm. 5-foot sidewalk is the minimum standard required, whether that be one or two sidewalks. So if you want a sidewalk on both sides of the street, they'd still be 5 feet wide per ordinance.
So we could strike that altogether. It would require 5 foot either way. I mean, a 5-foot sidewalk is going to be required either way.
A sidewalk would not be required at all unless you make it a condition, and you can condition it on one side or both sides.
Okay. I'm curious would the engineering department have a concern about the maintenance of a 4-foot wall versus a 5-foot wall if they did it as
a... It is really that our ordinance mirrors the ADA requirements.
Okay. I'll make a motion to amend. Well, I don't have to make a motion yet. You will.
You can clarify this.
Yeah, let me just.
Since it hasn't been seconded yet.
Okay. Let me clarify that on number item five, that the 4-foot sidewalk along both sides of each street will be stricken. So there is just a 5-foot sidewalk on one side of each street. I mentioned the applicant conditions 1-5. I didn't include 6 because that would conflict with condition, I think it was 13. In the applicant requested conditions. We need to put up the applicant requested conditions, or do I need to read them? It's in the applicant requested conditions. The ones that are in the book. So it's the one about the
So your motion is staff conditions, applicant requested conditions, except for number six, and the conditions that were shown on the screen a minute ago for you, right?
That's correct, except for number five has amended not to include the 4-foot sidewalk on the side of the street.
I'll second the motion. Is there any discussion?
I want to clarify that by voting on this now doesn't mean that the discussions have been closed. This still has to go to the Board of Commissioners for their approval. So any of the sewer issues or stormwater can still be worked out with them.
Commissioner Neal, your conversations with the applicant relative to the decrease of density from the requested density, they indicated, or you heard all what they desire to do. Is this going to go into larger lots, or is this going to go into some sort of open space or any other?
Well, the number of lots is reduced. It did not, the balance is left up to the applicant. There's a minimum lot size, of course. If they choose, since there's the same number of lots, if they choose to use all minimum lots, that means there's a greater balance of open space. And if they choose not to, then there would be a just larger lots. But it's going to be the same general impact since it's 49 residential units.
The density reduction, as I see, is from 2.49 to 2.25.
It would be roughly that. Yeah.
Any more discussion? We have a motion and a second. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Ridgeline Land Planning Incorporated, ZA 3667. Ms. Dalton.
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A1 and Single Family Residential District Res 3 to Single Family Residential District Res 3 on 21.74 acres for 38 residential lots with a density of 1.75 units per acre. This property is located at 945 and 951 Settles Road in 1680 and 1688 Thunder Gulch Pass, Suwanee, Georgia, 30024. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for Ridgeline Land Planning Incorporated, ZA 3667. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of Ridgeline Land Planning Incorporated, ZA 3667?
Madam Chair, Andrew Lipscomb here on behalf of Ridgeline Land Planning, Inc. In ZA 3667, this is a request for a Res 3 from Settles Road. Originally, we requested 43 lots on this zoning. That would have been a density of 1.97 homes per acre, with a 10,000 square foot lot minimum and a 2,000 square foot minimum house size with no zoning buffer. We had a revision to that later where we reduced the number of lots from 43 to 38, which reduced the overall density to 1.75, basically 1.748 units per acre. That also would have had a 10,000 square foot lot minimum and 2,000 square foot minimum house size. We more recently met with the neighborhood and agreed to a revision from the 38 lots, the original 43 lots, down to 32 lots, which produces a density of 1.47 homes per acre. We've increased the square footage of minimum for a lot to 12,500 square feet with an overall average of 16,000 square feet in a lot. And we've increased the lot size from 2,000 square foot minimum to 3,200 square foot minimum. We've agreed that all of the homes would have basements except for two of the homes which might not have basements. Those would be the first two moving into the subdivision. We've agreed to a 25-foot buffer on the lots adjacent to Grand Cascades, and we've agreed that the homes would be three sides of brick, stone, stucco, and we're now hoping that this would be a gated community, so that is an option that we're asking for, to have the option to have a gated community. That we've had some very cooperative meetings with the neighbors in Grand Cascades and other of the neighborhoods there. I want to thank those folks for their cooperation and help in dealing with these issues. We've also been aware and met with another group from Grand Cascades, which has been doing extensive work on their ponds and stormwater management for the ponds and for the drainage area which runs into those ponds. And we're cooperating with those folks because some of the water passes through the property, which is the subject of this rezoning, prior to it reaching those ponds. So they have an interest, and we do too, in making sure that the siltation and sediment is contained as it required to be under the laws of the state of Georgia and ordinance of this county. This proposed zoning conforms to the future land use map, future development map, it's called that, and the comprehensive plan. The staff is supportive of the zoning. We're glad to answer any questions.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in support of ZA 3667? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition to ZA 3667? Mr. Meadows, did you fill your form out?
I did, ma'am.
If you'll state your name first.
My name is Jeff Meadows, resident of Grand Cascades, and Jason. Question. This is PowerPoint. Again, my name is Jeff Meadows. I live in Grand Cascades. I want to thank the Board of Commissioners, the Planning Commissioners, everyone has been very available, very helpful, as has the county staff. I also want to thank our community, as you see behind us. They've been very supportive and very active. Regarding where we're at, we have had two very good meetings with Emory, Brett, the developer, and Holt, the applicant. We were very excited about the first meeting we had, and I will say courage, not excited, by what we heard. And we proactively reached out to Emory and the applicant in an effort to try to come to an agreement. They were receptive, if you want to note that. But as of the last meeting, they stated very, very clearly that the lots adjacent to Grand Cascade lots, which are 33,000 square feet to 25,500 square feet around that area, we're going to be 12,500 square feet. That's just not acceptable. On that point alone, we're going to ask for this to be denied. The other points that we saw on the plat was that on some of the adjacent lots to Grand Cascades, there were up to three lots in development. So there'd be three lots per one plot. Again, we can't accept that at this point in time. So we asked, again, this be denied. We had over 200 folks at our first meeting in January. We had Lambeth High School graduation today, and dinners, parties, et cetera, tonight. So our numbers are down quite a bit, but I still want to thank our community for their support and participation. From the beginning, our compromise proposal to the developer applicant, Emory, was 18,500 square foot lots, which is res 2. That's based upon the fact, again, that the adjacent lots in Grand Cascades are 33,000 to 25,000 square feet. Lots within the neighborhood are just as large as that. So the total neighborhood has lots even larger than that. We are asking for lot widths the same width as the adjacent lots currently there. And that was suggested to us by a board of commissioners member in District 2, because he said that had worked well in previous zoning, recent zoning. We asked for a 50-foot undisturbed buffer. Again, it could be a combination of a disturbed buffer that would be replanted and hopefully undisturbed buffer. We asked that the easements of the Baker property be legally abandoned because we do not want a through road being built from Champion Run or any other adjacent property to Settles Road. And of course, we asked for protection of our lakes, our streams, and Grand Cascades, and also on the property itself. So with that, we need to ask for you folks to consider denying this request. And Ms. Shaw would like to speak next.
Thank you, Mr. Levin.
Thank you.
Ms. Shaw, did you turn your...
I did.
Thank you. State your name first, please.
Yes. My name is Liz Shaw, and I'm a resident of the Grand Cascades subdivision. I would like, first of all, to slide this here. I would like to first of all to draw your attention to a number of points in the Forsyth County Comprehensive Plan, which relate to the property under discussion, and to clarify why we are asking for res 2 zoning. The map clearly shows that there are two character areas, the upper portion being Baker properties in the blue area, which is the suburban living character area, whereas the remaining, a much larger portion, is in the river residential character area, below that, the green area. I want to focus on river residential, as the property is mainly in that designation. Typically, this area is characterized by lower housing densities, larger lots, stream buffers, and natural areas. In fact, this is exactly what you see when you drive down Settles Road and pass existing homes and the Settles Cove, Cascade Run, and Grass Run Cascade subdivision. A very distinctive character area, very distinctive from suburban living. The zoning map, which follows, clearly shows that R2R, which is on either side of the subject property, and Res 2, which is the Grand Cascade subdivision to the south, are the predominant adjacent zonings. There is Res 3 zoning to the north, surrounding the Baker property. That, however, is buffered from Champions Run by the stream and the associated buffers. This slide, I think, really points to the concern that we have. The property is infill development, so we feel that it's really important that it should be compatible with the existing developments, as stated in the comprehensive plan and section 8-5.5 subsection F of the Unified Development Code. This slide clearly indicates actual adjacent lot sizes which range from a minimum of 20,000 square feet to more than 50,000 square feet. A larger view of the Greater Settles Road area shows the major streams and the stream and the lakes into which this subject property drains. And this is a great concern, as other developments along this stream corridor have already caused major sediment issues in the downstream lakes. I want now just to go back to the comprehensive plan. With my next slide, the text in black highlights the most relevant and critical development strategies. The first being to encourage new residential development to blend with existing housing through appropriate open space and buffering requirements. And I'm not going to take the time reading the rest of them, but I do want to make a point under the development guidelines for proper residential that new residential development must, and I emphasize, must respect the scale and character of adjacent residential neighborhoods. Let me go to my conclusion. So in conclusion, this is why we are, these points are why we are asking or feel that we have no alternative but to ask for a res 2 zoning and denial of the res 3 request. Because the larger lots would be more compatible. We're asking for appropriate buffering, closure of the access easement to Thunder Gulch, and no negative water runoff and sedimentation impacts to the adjacent properties. And I realize that some of these points have been addressed, but the compatible lot sizes is the one area that we have not come to agreement. In the end, we all want the highest and best use as an outcome in the best interests of the property owners and the surrounding community. The process is still not finalized, and we are respectfully asking for your consideration of our request to deny the application for this three zoning. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? You have 1 minute and 42 seconds.
This is Craig Klein from the HOA. I'm secretary of the HOA. I will probably need and may ask for the committee to do an extension of time because I'll probably need about 2 or 3 minutes rather than the time that I'll get into it there now.
2 or 3 minutes total?
3 minutes total.
3 minutes total. Why don't we go ahead and extend this 2 more minutes? I make a motion to extend the time 2 more minutes so that we have 3 minutes and 23 seconds. Seconded by Commissioner Dolezal. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion to extend the time, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0.
Thank you very much. I do appreciate that. Again, my name is Greg Klein. I'm Secretary of the Grand Cascades Homeowners Association, and I'm authorized by the HOA Board to speak before you here. And I want to echo everything that Mr. Maddow said in his group. We're fully supportive of that, and I think all those points are well taken. I'm addressing one very specific issue dealing with the sedimentation and environmental impact of this proposed development. And I just want to very briefly talk about Grand Cascades history right now because it's very significant to the entire issue. Grand Cascades has been wrestling with this issue of sedimentation in its town for the last 2 or 3 years. This has all been caused by upstream development, dumped sediment into our lakes. Time and time again, we've seen this. It's happening now and it's happening fast. This affects not only the residents of Grand Cascades, because it causes the loss of the lake area, which turns into wetlands, but also our lakes feed into the Chattahoochee. This affects everyone downstream, millions of people. Sedimentation going there is a significant issue. Because of the seriousness of this issue, Grand Cascades has made the extraordinary step of hiring Schnabel Engineering almost 3 years ago at a significant cost, which I think is pretty extraordinary for anyone to do, in the subdivision. We asked them to study the issue, report back to the HOA, craft solutions to the issue, and oversee the sedimentation removal and dam repair. We are now at the stage where we're implementing corrective measure. We're all excited about that. Then this development comes on. ZA3667. Naturally, we were very interested in what was happening. So we engaged Schnabel Engineering to look into this, to see what impact this additional development would have onto our issue. And the reason it's significant was that Schnabel confirmed the entire ZA3667 property was in the watershed, all of it's in the watershed of our upper lake. So we actively engaged the developer, Ridgeline, and also Embry about this, and to seek information so that Schnabel could make an evaluation. They asked for two very specific things. One was their stormwater management plan, and number two, very modest request of allowing Chuck Wilson, the engineer of Schnabel, to walk the property and to take samples from a handoff. Now, the developer was forthcoming with some of these issues, however, they refused to allow him to take soil samples, which is critical. We're very disappointed. We also found that this is very ironic that the property owners are not allowing us to take soil samples. But 2 weeks before our request, they had heavy equipment doing soil samples, and the reason they say they won't let us do it is they don't want the land disturbed. So here's what we're asking. We're aware that they made two changes very late. We got them about 2 hours before this hearing. One, we definitely want Schnabel to be able to take soil samples and conduct their study so that we know the extent of the problem. And we ask that this request be deferred, that Schnabel has been able to take those soil samples and do the report. Or alternatively, have the county do a water report, which is happening up in Champions Run.
Madam Chair, this time.
I can just have one more minute.
One more minute.
Just says 123.
It's wrong. Justin's trying to keep up with it by hand. It quit working again. What's the pleasure of the board?
If he's finishing at this point, I'd like to know.
Okay. 30 seconds.
We'll vote. I'll make a motion to extend the time one more minute. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion on that? All in favor of the motion to extend the time one more minute, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to extend the time one more minute passes 5-0. Okay, okay.
Thank you. So we want to defer, we would ask to defer this until Schnabel or the county has conducted a proper hydrological survey so we know the extent of sedimentation runoff will happen with this development, number one. That's not addressing the changes. Number two, we also want a firm commitment from the developer that they will provide remediation for sedimentation that is dumped into our lakes, which we feel will surely happen. And that could take a little financial compensation to so that we can pay for the sediment removal that will be removed from our lakes. And with those two qualifications, we very much like the city. I want to thank you for your time and your considerations.
Thank you, Mr.
Clark.
We extended the time. We have 1 minute.
You have 18 seconds left.
We have 18 seconds left. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition for 18 seconds?
And there's a gentleman right here.
Department of Record for me, Jack Lees, Networkers Hark Road. I'm their environmental compliance officer. I walked the property. It was not posted to no trespassing. Beautiful property. It's got a lot more water out than it's been depicted on the drawing. So I would encourage you to, whatever buffers you do, undisturbed buffers, clarify that they're undisturbed, and I would strongly encourage you to have an independent party walk the property for city walks, as there are extensive.
It's time, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Gleason.
Madam Chair, just wanted to let you know that we do have at least one other gentleman who wishes to speak in opposition, just for the board's information.
No, it's not in opposition.
Just 1 minute, sir, and let us see if we can extend some time. I make a motion to extend the time one more minute. Seconded by Commissioner Dolezal. All in favor to extend the time one more minute, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Sir, did you fill a form out?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and would you state your name?
My name is Philip Baker.
Thank you.
We are selling the property to bridge line. And some of the statements that have been made tonight based on not being allowed to get on the property. There was almost a month ago that documents were signed for their engineers to come in and inspect the property. They have stalled in doing that. Now, I understand Grant Cascade's concern about the settlement. I've been dealing with it for the last, over 10 years now, that when Rockland was Windmark, but Champion Glen Subdivision, and have dealt with it for many years. Now, I did go down to Snoddle and look at what they had suggested to Champion Glen. And the fact is...
I'm sure that's time.
The fact is, they have...
Do you think that if we have you one more minute, you could complete this?
Yes.
Speaking of things, we have this up.
Yes, but we have time for a rebuttal.
That's fine.
Oh, wait, just one minute. Let's see what happens.
We will, I believe it is appropriate to consider as rebuttal time. There was time.
5 points.
Yeah. 5 points plus actually three additional minutes that were extended.
Okay, so.
So there. We're, that leaves us with 7 minutes and 42 seconds.
Okay, so. I make a motion to extend the time one more minute.
I don't believe it's necessary to consider this.
Oh, it's not?
Since he's speaking in favor.
Okay, this is rebuttal. I get it now. Sorry. I'm sorry.
And that probably was my fault for coming out of position. I misunderstood him when he indicated he was still wishing to speak.
Okay. All right. You're fine. I'm sorry that I had to interrupt. All right. Now, go ahead.
However, having gone down to Snoddle's, who the engineering company is that Grant Cascade hired, they have found that because the landowners around the lakes created their property line right to the lake, they have added to the silt and everything that's right on there. And they are requesting, and I think there is a permit that they have requested in order to have dredging done around the lakes. Now, I agree that Grand Cascades and the development by originally Windmark Homes and then Rockland Homes has created this. However, the pond that I have had for over 30 years has collected a lot of this silt. And they are protected because of our pond and the pond below us before it gets to Grand Cascades. And there are two lakes down there. If they would actually go back and look, they would find that they have created part of the problem themselves. And we have blocked it and it getting down to them. You're more than welcome to come out and look and see that our pond is almost 3/4 full of silt that has come from the development. So this complaint with them about the waters. I agree with them. I have dealt with it for many, many years. However, my wife and I are at an age that we're ready to move on. And I think this will be a good development for the county. If y'all would look at that and see that the homes are larger than in Grand Cascades, and the only reason that the size of the lots are smaller is because this is going to have sewage. They have septic tanks. And that is something that they're not willing to discuss open and honestly with the board. That's all I've got to say.
Thank you, Mr. Baker. So now does Mr. Lipscomb have time as well?
Yes, and I'm doing the math.
Our timer is acting up, so we're having to do this by hand.
I show 6 minutes and 26 seconds.
Okay.
There was 5 minutes and 42 seconds. Three additional minutes were added. He spoke for 2 minutes and 16 seconds, leaving total 6:26.
For Mr. Lipscomb to rebut?
Yes.
Or whoever. Would you like to have your say?
Yes, thank you. You know, I think that some of the things that have been said here have been rebutted in part by what Phil said. The lights that were shown as being much larger lots are served for wastewater purposes with septic tanks rather than sewer. This is going to be on the county sewer. This property is. Mr. Gleason said that the county should have someone to go on the property and determine whether the waters of the state have been correctly shown, and that has been done, and the person who is designated for making that determination has been on the property and has determined that they are correctly shown. So that has been done. The concern about the road that came down from the north not being allowed to be a through road, that concern is one of ours also, and we have asked and we have agreed that that not be allowed to continue. So that is not an issue. We're in full support of terminating that road. We are cooperating with both the Jeff Meadows, Liz Shaw group, and Greg Klein's group. It's taking longer than all of us would like for some of that work to get done, but we are continuing to cooperate and will through the Board of Commissioners meeting. We have the same desire that they do, and that is to make sure that this development fits the area. We submit to you that it will. The price of homes and the gating of the community will reflect very favorably on that area down there. The road improvements recommended by the engineering department will be made, making that a safer area there. I think that covers the points that I wanted to make.
Thank you. I make a motion to close the public hearing for Ridgeline Land Planning Incorporated, ZA 3667. May I have a second? Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. The board can ask questions now if they choose to. Does anybody have any questions about anything?
Wait,
before you do that, I need to ask staff something. We've had a commissioner exit the room for a short period of time. Do we need to not continue, or
if you were finished with the public hearing and there was no further testimony provided, you could proceed. If Commissioner Hoyt sounded like you might have some relevant questions, the question response should be the commissioner present.
Okay.
Or preferably would be if she's short.
So should we just like take a 5-minute recess or a 3-minute recess or?
A recess until Commissioner Mills returns I
make a motion to recess the meeting until Commissioner Mills returns. I really don't think it'll be but a couple of minutes, so please don't everybody get up and run off. May I have a second?
Second.
That motion is seconded by Commissioner Dolezal to take a
Just getting you a business card to contact me.
Oh, well, thank you.
Okay, never mind. We're going to withdraw the motion and withdraw the second and carry on. That's okay. Commissioner Hoyt, now I believe you do have some questions, correct?
Yes.
I got the business card.
First one is about stormwater, and I believe Mr. Klein was talking about this, but also Mr. Gleason and Mr. Baker too, I guess. But as I'm understanding it and looking at the diagram, there's a stream that comes down from the property to the west that passes through this property on its way through ponds and into the lake at the bottom of the hill. And as I understand it, the grading that would be done in this proposed subdivision hadn't been done yet. So does anybody have any information about where all the sediment that's in the ponds now comes from? Because I've heard expressed a fear that there's going to be a lot more, and I think Mr. Klein mentioned something about liability of somebody to somebody, and I don't know that that's part of our bailiwick if people get into wanting financial compensation from each other. But I would like to hear what the situation now is with sediment and the source of it, if anybody knows.
So is Mr. Klein who you would like to answer?
Well, Mr. Klein or any of the people who spoke with him, Mr. Klein first, if possible.
Mr. Klein, could you come forward, please?
I would be interested in hearing if Schnabel could actually address that in there.
Yes.
What the current cause was.
Yes, so maybe somebody from the applicant can tell us that.
And stating that again.
Yeah, great client, Secretary of the Grand States, HOA. I think this all points to the need of actually doing stuff. I mean, we can all get up here and suppose and say, well, this stream goes in here, oh, it's taking much sediment from the earth and rebuttal. But no one does. We need to have a study done. Schnabel needs some basic cooperation to do this. We feel very strongly, since all this property's in the watershed, it's going to dump sediment into our upper lake that we just cleaned or we're getting ready to clean. So yes, it will do it. We feel very confident it will do it. We want to know the extent which that will occur, and we need a study to do that. And this has all been done too quickly from our viewpoint, and this needs to be researched. No one can say how much it is. We've gotten, and they have been forthcoming, developers have been forthcoming with some information, but they don't know. We need to have a study. Champions Run, the county has brought in Schnabel to do a study for Champions Run. This could easily be rolled up. Really, all three properties need to be under the same type of study. They're all interrelated. In fact, part of the dam, Champions Run, is owned, is on the property of ZA3667. So it just makes a lot of sense to do the study, find out what's going to happen. On the remediation point, we're asking for future remediation. We're not asking for remediation right now. We want it in the zone. But the developer's going to commit to that. If sediment is being dumped into our lakes, if we have the right to ask for remediation, I think that's only fair. And we've been wrangling this issue for years and spending a significant amount of money to clean it up.
Is it your position that you don't have a remedy for remediation through nuisance or the courts or something else the way anybody else does, apart from whatever the zoning conditions are?
That's an excellent question. Certainly there's remediation from the courts. We've just done that. Our community went through a lawsuit with Wheeling Homes over our lakes and dams. The last thing we want to do is repeat that whole process. And this should be addressed here. I don't see why we're creating problems and not addressing solutions. Just to create another problem that we have to resolve through litigation. I'm an attorney. The last thing that we need is more work for attorneys. Let's get this taken care of now.
Did that answer your question, Mr.
No, but that's
Mr. Hoyt? Do you have a question for Mr. Baker, or are you done?
Yes, I'd like to ask everybody first, and then Mr. Baker.
Yes, no problem.
Maybe you both.
I just wanted to...
I'd like to ask that same question of the two of you.
Okay. What I would like to say is that we have turned over our sedimentation study to Mr. Klein's group. We had a study done there on just the property that we have for you here. And of course, as you know, the county, before it allows any development of that property, is going to determine that the stormwater management plan has been properly prepared and is in place. And there's a lot of interest in this. My client was very interested in it, and for that reason employed their own consultant who's been on the ground and is cooperating with Snobble Engineering. And
has a report been written yet?
I'm going to let Hope for a second. Hope is the individual who's more familiar with this than I am, and I'd like you to speak to that.
Person. And actually, we contracted Contour Environmental to do our state waters assessment, and we also hired them to do a sedimentation report to determine how much sedimentation is currently coming into that stream and passing through the property from the Settles Cove subdivision and their two family retention ponds. And as I planned also, once before LDP is issued, to do another sedimentation study to see how much, you know, if we get a baseline of now, before LDP and during construction. So we're documenting sedimentation, and we've already provided them that initial sedimentation study in the meeting we have with Rick Klein and their group several weeks ago.
The sedimentation study, is that getting elevations in the lake, or is that in the stream?
In the stream passing through our property.
Okay. And you only looked at your property, is that correct?
Correct, as far as that sedimentation goes. So, I mean, we provided that to them so they can see the current sedimentation in the stream that is going to come through our property, then obviously flow into their property. So in the next several samplings, we'll be able to see how much is already there before we even touch the ground, because the sedimentation is there before we turn any dirt. So.
Do you know if Contour followed up with a jurisdictional determination with the Corps?
We met with Simon Wilkes on site and had a determination. And there, everything was, he agreed with what we currently have submitted.
Is that meeting with Simon what Mr. Lipscomb's referencing when he says that the proper person is wanting to determine state waters?
No, I can't remember the exact date, but that was done in January.
Mr. Hoyt, you have the same question as Mr. Belker, is that correct?
Only if there's any additional information on that point.
I've actually had Simon Wilkes out on the property numerous occasions and Jeff Bishop with the EPD to evaluate the settlement that's coming down. Now that's being created from the development of Champions Run upstream. Now, like I had stated earlier, we have a small pond that actually is basically nothing but a retention pond now. And you're welcome to come out and look at it, and you'll see that, you know, it's half full of soot that's coming down. So Grand Cascades is being protected by that pond and the lower lake that's above Grand Cascades. They're both considered retention ponds by the county. They have been out, they have evaluated everything, they have actually done studies on it. Actually, there is a basin study that was done. If you want to contact Renee, with county engineering, she clarified every bit of this. I'm not trying to deny the fact that there is an issue. And with the new development coming in, yes, the water has to be protected. I do not deny that from Grand Cascades whatsoever. However, if their honesty had been from their disclosure of the fact that a lot of their issues on wanting their, with them wanting to dredge around the So, and my wife and I rode horses all through there. I know those lakes. All they've got to do is step up and say, they have created part of this problem too. It's not the development upstream that has created all of it. When you take a piece of land and you clear it all the way down to a lake, what kind of runoff are you going to get? We all know that. I mean, that's a fact of life. So, you know, I don't disagree with people from Grand Cascades. However, the only difference in this development is they are larger houses. However, they're smaller lots, only based on the fact that there's going to be sewage and not septic tanks. That's it. I wish I could tell you more, but I'm sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Baker.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you satisfied?
Yeah, that answers my question.
Okay.
Still have a question? Madam Chairman, that may be out of order. I apologize. I've run the studies by the engineer.
Madam Chairman,
Commissioner
Dellazon,
did you have a question?
I just had a quick question for Mr. Klein relative to the assertion that you were offered access to the property but didn't take it. If given access to the property, has Schnabel indicated to you the turnaround time for the sediment study?
Quick lunch of the HOA again. We feel they can do it quickly. I mean, they haven't given us the time. But the problem is, it's not just, they will walk, Chuck Olson and Sean will be able to walk the property. He needs to take soil samples. That's just as critical. Because, as he explained to me, type of soil, sandy, clay, what have you, that's surrounded, directly affects when the land disturbance happens, directly affects what's going on. I think they can do it in a reasonable time. Did I commit a certain period of time? We certainly would push it to get it done, but we need to have full cooperation on that. And when I went back and talked a little bit about that, that they had allowed testing before, I think the gentleman we just testified, they actually came and looked at our records, Grand Cascade records. And we opened our door. Schnabel and ourselves, we let them see everything we've done with the dams and lakes. When we asked for reciprocity to do testing, basically with a handoff. No, we don't want our land disturbed.
So what you're asking for is some cores to be drilled and actually get soil samples.
Yeah, so with a handoff, no power tools. He just, as he walks the property, he just takes soil samples.
We did give him permission.
And y'all did not do it.
Commissioner Dozal, are you satisfied?
Yeah, I would just like to ask a follow-up question, Mr. Lipscomb. If I'd like to inquire if your client would be willing to allow those studies to be done between now and the Board of Commissioners meeting.
There's a meeting, I understand, scheduled at 10 o'clock this Thursday morning. So I expect that we'll have some order at that time. What we had been hopeful was knowing that this is a hot issue in this county because most tracts of land in this county have some streams on them. So protection of our streams and against sediment, getting into people's ponds and lakes is a big time issue. And what we had expected was that based on the experience that we're having, we now have all come to understand that the state regulates this very, very tightly, and that we have people here on the staff that will regulate it, and will see to it that those regulations are followed, and that you would take action tonight, believing that that would be the case, and that this would pass on to the Board of Commissioners, and that at some point in time that would be resolved with the county and with the state EPD.
So you're meeting for Thursday to determine whether or not they will be allowed to take these.
I would hope that would be the case.
They have action.
So, right. Contour and Brian on Snobbler set to walk the site Thursday.
And 10. They will be allowed to.
I'm trying to take those steps right now. I don't have that information.
Okay.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
The property owner is here, is that?
If the property owner is amenable to that, is that not where you would need to get permission from?
Sure.
Am I confused as to where you received permission
from
to get
the
landowners? Is he not here?
He's one of the landowners. There are other landowners besides Mr. Trash.
Sorry. Okay. So we can say for sure that on his piece of land, we're good.
Commissioner Goff, did you have
a question? Yes. I know for a fact that I have seen in another area of the county what I thought was an extremely detailed map, I would say down to almost a square yard, showing every kind of soil that was in that subdivision. And I was led to believe that, although I don't know what department, engineering or perhaps GIS, that we already had maps outlining what the soil types were throughout the county. Now, I may have misunderstood what I was told, but I thought that was already the case. Can anybody speak to that?
I know we have generalized information on soil types across the county. How detailed it is as far as site-specific information in terms of current conditions, I would have to check with GIS. I don't know offhand. But we do have a generalized map in the comprehensive plan of the basic soil types.
But if you check with engineering, you'll find out they have done a basic study.
I need to either come down or respond to a question. Or
I believe the soils that are in GIS are in our CS maps. So it's they look at vegetation and they do a sample of borings and then they figure out indicators. But I guess that they're looking for very specific soil texture to see how cohesive it is.
I think it'd be important to know that one way or another.
Would say, I mean, no matter what type of soils there are upstream, the state has limits on the how much the discharge can have, which is very, very low. So they, you know, if it gets exceeded, then you know there's potential penalties for that. But there is a numeric criteria for how much is exceeding is intermittent.
So, Commissioner Hoyt, this is District 5. Are you prepared to make a motion for a recommendation?
After I ask one more question, if I may.
Okay.
The applicant has submitted a proposed condition 15,
yes, sir,
which says the applicant shall continue to work with representatives of the Grand Cascades HOA prior to the Board of Commissioners meeting in order to conduct a site visit of the subject property with the HOA's engineer and the applicant's engineer to identify streams located on the property. Would you have a problem with adding to that and sample soils located on the property so that that gets done before the Board of Commissioners meeting?
I'm not in a position to say that. I think what has come up with the problem is there have been a lot of people going on to these landowners' property there without getting permission, feeling that there wasn't anything wrong with coming on to the property and taking samples and doing whatever they cared to do on the property. And the landowners got fed up with that and they said no more of that. Now we have agreed, and as you've heard, there's going to be a walkover of the property this Thursday. And I would hope that at that time there would be an agreement, but I don't want to tell you something that I don't know the answer to. I would hope that would be the case by Thursday, that they would be able to give that permission as Attorney Klein has suggested for the soil samples to be taken, but I don't have the authority right now to take it. Certainly, we're expecting them to make that walk over and hopefully that will be allowed.
Obviously, Mr. Baker has already said that that's acceptable on his property. We just need a confirmation from Mr. Harris, who is the property owner. I'm not comfortable giving that permission without speaking to him because we don't own the property or not. So as soon as we confirm that, we can get that done before the Thursday meeting, but if you will,
I want to make sure that no one takes what I said, that Mr. Klein or any of his people have come on the property without permission. They've been very careful to ask for permission. We've had a meeting with the consultants in our office and with Mr. Klein, and all been very satisfactory. So I didn't mean by what I was saying that any of those folks, there have been other people who've gone onto the property without permission, certainly not the Grand Cascade.
Thank you. Commissioner Hoyt?
Are we getting squirrel conditions or am I getting this?
Squirrel moment.
I move that the Planning Commission recommend to the Board of Commissioners approval of the application ZA-3667 submitted by Ridgeline Land Planning for rezoning of 21.74 acres in Commission District 5 for 32 residential lots with a density of 1.472 units per acre on the property at 945 and 951 Settles Road and 1680 and 1688 Thunder Gulch Pass, Sewanee, Georgia, 30024, tax map and parcel numbers 179-041 and 180-026 from the Agricultural District A1 to Single Family Residential District Res 3, as shown on the concept plan dated 5-22-2014, subject to the following conditions. And I think you have the plan if you can skip that on the scroll. And the conditions that I would include are the engineering condition number one, the water and sewer conditions 1, 2, and 3, the additional zoning conditions requested by the applicant 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, adding to 6 the language stream buffers and stormwater system to be maintained by the HOA. Condition 6, 7, 8, which includes no more than 32 homes, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and there's a second 15, don't ask me why. No permanent access between the subject property and Thunder Gulch Road from the north side of the subject property, and then adding applicant's latest proposed condition 15.
Would it be 17?
I think it would be at least 17. Yes. Have you got that?
Yes.
And then you have, I believe, those two conditions.
I'd like to make an amendment.
Do we have a second?
You will. we will need a second before we can amend it.
Okay, so I'll second.
Okay.
And I'd like to amend. As stated, but I'd like to amend condition 9 to state lots shall have no less than 12,500 square feet, with the average lot size being 18,000 square feet.
Is there a second to the amendment? The amendment motion dies for lack of a second. Now we're back to the main motion.
I'd like to make a motion to amend condition number 9 to read lot size. Lot shall not have less than 15,000 square feet, with the average lot size being 18,000 square feet.
Yes.
Is there a second to the amendment? That motion dies for lack of a second. Now we're back to the main motion.
I'd like to make an amendment to strike stream buffers and stormwater system from the membership and homeowner association. Shall we? Well, that's number 5.
Number 5.
Yeah, and the reason why I'm saying that is just because in the future, you know, a lot of metro area has, because of state requirements, they've ended up creating stormwater utilities, and this would kind of perpetually create a conflict with something if it ever changed at the county level where they decided to become a stormwater utility. And right now, they're already required to, by the engineering standards, they're required to accept those.
So your amendment is just to strike the words stream buffers and stormwater system from condition number 5 about homeowners association?
I would accept that.
And the stream buffers portion is just because it's supposed to remain natural, so you really don't have to.
Commissioner Hoyt, was that a second?
I was accepting that as an amendment or seconding it, whichever is more effective.
Okay. So we have a motion for an amendment. We have a second. Please vote on the amendment.
Before you vote, just call for a discussion, please.
I'm sorry. Is there any discussion? There being no discussion, all those in favor of the motion, please, of the amendment, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? The amendment motion passes 5-0. Now we're back to the main motion.
I'd like to make another motion to amend item 9 to read lots shall have not less than 14,000 square feet, with the average lot size being 18,000 square feet. And I'd like to state that this would be very compatible on sewer, as we do have a number of developments in the county that have sewer on similar, if not larger, lot sizes.
Second.
We have an amendment and we have a second. A motion to amend. We also have a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the amendment, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed? That motion fails.
Wow.
That motion fails 3-2.
To amend item 9 to read lots shall not have less than 12,500 square feet, with the average lot size being 18,000 square feet.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second for an amendment. Is there any discussion?
I do a point of discussion. The surrounding lot size, I stated this in our work session, that the surrounding average lot size is 18,625 feet. So I believe that this at the minimum is something that we can do to be in line with the intent of the UDC.
All those in favor of the amendment motion, please signify by raising your hand.
Being 17,000 square feet.
Second.
We have an amendment motion and a second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, amendment motion, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed?
Boo!
Motion passes 3-2.
Follow your own plan. You don't even live there.
You got you in your pocket.
Item number 17.
Excuse me, before proceeding, I just want to make sure I heard the announcement correct. What was the vote on that last motion to amend?
The motion was 3-2.
It failed.
It failed. Okay. And thank you. Can we see item number 17, please?
Thank you.
I'd like to inquire about the enforceability. I think it's 17. It's wherever we stated that they will do such and such before the VOC meeting, that they will be able to do the soil samples. I guess this is a question for the council, but I don't know if we have the ability to mandate that in their recommendation.
As a practical matter, logically, anything to happen before it's approved is not going to have any impact once it would potentially be approved, or Commissioner Cohen would not adopt something like that at that point in time.
So, Mr. Horn, I wonder if we should make a motion to recommend that the DOC require that prior to an LDP as opposed to.
Can you say that last sentence again?
Considering that motion really has no enforcement mechanism, I'm wondering if we should make that, if we should amend that item, such as a requirement of the development as opposed to a requirement of development prior to the DOC meeting.
Yeah, if you want to make that motion.
I don't exactly know how it like before, but I would make a motion to strike the words prior to the Board of Commissioners meeting from item 7.
You're leaving in soil samples, though?
Yes.
I would recommend that you include a time frame. Leaving it open-ended suggests the potential
prior to the submission
sometime in the future.
I make a motion to strike from item 17 the words prior to the Board of Commissioners meeting and replace it with the verbiage prior to the approval of a land service plan.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion about them? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion to amend passes 5-0. Now we're back to the main motion.
I'd like to make an amendment to item 9. Lots shall have not less than 14,500 square feet.
Second.
We have a motion to amend and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes
three, two opposed, three, four. Is that correct? Commissioner Dolezal and Commissioner Bowman were opposed. Commissioner Iglesias, Commissioner Hoyt, and Commissioner Neal were in favor of the motion. Is that got it?
We have it, Chair.
Thank you. Next is 1202 Holdings LLC, ZA 3668. I make a motion for a 3 minute recess. May I have a second? Seconded by Commissioner Dahlonega. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion for a 3 minute recess, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0.
I'm sorry. I
going to work out.
There you go.
Perfect. We ready? Aye, Commissioner.
Yes.
Aye. As Emery said, Jay Land, I am the owner, I'm the applicant, I'm the developer. As my kids say, I'm the chief stall cleaner. I feel a little unloved after the last one. My property, I've lived here for a long time in the county. When I decided it was time for my family to develop this property, I went to a number of my builder friends. I'm a commercial developer. I don't know anything about building houses, but I do know about developing real estate. And I knew that I wanted to find a quality builder to be my venture partner in the project so that I could stay involved, so that I could continue to own it, so that I could really see this very important piece of real estate through to the end, to create a new vibrant use, a new vibrant community, a new exciting modern place, and I needed the right partner that shared that vision. Obviously, there were a number of builders who were very excited for the opportunity. I'm proud to say that that my friend Paul Corley of Edward Andrews Homes decided that he'd like to participate with me. I wanted a builder that shared my vision, that also had the financial backing, having lived through the last 8 years, as we all have. It's important to have solid footing. So in addition to my expertise, he brings a lot to the table. He'll speak in a moment specifically about some of the development concepts for the site. I'd like to just acquaint you quickly with the real estate. This is an aerial shot. The site is located in the center. It's 143 acres altogether. We've got 25 acres on the west side of Mullinax Road and 118 on the east. It's bounded by Georgia 400, McFarland Road, Highway 9, Mullinax Road and Fowler Road, and there's the property in the middle of it. So obviously it's very well located. In addition, the site has, if you look at the blow up here, you can see the 25 acres on the west and 118 on the east. We have directly adjacent to me 10 acres of zone neighborhood shopping. Just adjacent to that is the development for Lennar, approved Res 4 back at the end of last year. And then here, this is a Ryland deal that was that's being built out now today, just to the south of Mullinax. We've got a sewer line that runs directly through my property, major trunk line there. And in addition, just recently, the commissioners approved the widening, moved the schedule for the widening of the Mullinax Road up, so that's going to become a four-lane divided median road that runs through my property. I'm going to let Paul talk about our layout for the project, the different types of housing. I just want to mention that my goal here is to create a community of homes that have character, that work together, that are not monotonous, that create, you'll see here when he talks about this, five different lot sizes. This is something that's not being done. Most of the residential developments that you're seeing are showing all the same size lots. And we're going to do something different. I think this is the location to do it. And I think it's the type of product that people will be happy to call home, and it will help support and drive values for my neighbors in the area directly, and also for even the existing homes that may not cost as much today as these homes will cost in some of the other surrounding neighborhoods. But the quality of this project will help drive those values long term. Paul, if you want to talk for more, I'll be happy to answer any questions y'all have.
Thank you, Chad. I'm Paul Corley, the CEO of Edward Andrews Homes. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you tonight. A little bit about my company. Edward Andrews builds all across North Atlanta, from Sandy Springs and Buckhead, all the way up into South Forsyth. We're very active in South Forsyth, currently in Marseille, and also in Pleasanton, over off Old Atlanta Road and Greystone, Southeast Forsyth also. And I feel very fortunate to be partnering with Jay on this property. I don't think you can overstate the fact that the builder after builder come to him and say, look, here's an all-cash offer, and walk away. And, you know, Jay's lived on this property for over 30 years. It's a beautiful piece of property. It's not only his residence, but it's his equestrian farm. So it's a bit special to he and his family. And I'm fortunate to be his partner. You know, as he showed on the map, one of the unique things, really unique things and opportunistic things from a development standpoint about the property is proximity to McFarland Road and the 400. The widening of Mullinax Road. I mean, it's one of the most southernmost pieces of property in the county. It actually has an Alpharetta address in Forsyth County, which is really unique. As Jay described, you know, our vision is for a master plan community that it's for not only to be one of the top communities here in Forsyth, but of all of Atlanta. And I think we have an opportunity with the location and the quality of this piece of property. Our vision from a housing standpoint was to have a mix of product and price points. We have five different lot sizes that range from 65 feet to 92 feet. Square footages on the homes that will raise range from 2,500 to over 4,500 square feet, and I'm going to show you some of those later. And then price points that are really from the 300s to over 700,000. And when Jay talks about quality, quality is what brings value. And one of the things that we're in agreement on is, if you look, this is our entrance design by Joel Bowman's group at the BNC Design. The amount of monies that we will put into the entrances. Also, if you look on this plan, you'll see numerous community parks that are intertwined throughout the neighborhood. And this is all, this is not just pretty green pictures, it's all usable property. This property is a significant amount of pasture and then a mixture of planted pines and hardwoods. But all the parks that are throughout the community are all usable, will be fully landscaped. You can see an example here of our amenity package, which will include four tennis courts. It shows two, we've agreed to do four. Junior Olympic pool with a kiddie pool to the side, an outdoor cabana house, and then it kind of feeds down to the central park for the community, bordered on both sides by two of the three lakes. From a housing perspective, we're very proud of our product. We use Roger Caldwell and Dale Peak, and both of these architects will be involved in the project, and these are some of our current elevations that we use throughout Metro Atlanta. It'll be a mix of materials, brick, stone, cement, siding. You know, we do not want to have a monotonous look. We don't want to have all bricks for front homes. We really want to bring some character to the neighborhood and offer different types of elevations and floor plans. But we think, you know, with the location, with the amount of that's going to be invested in this community, it's going to be a real success. We'd like to save the rest of the time for rebuttal. Any questions later? Thanks.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Please come forward. Did you fill your form out?
Yes, ma'am. Okay,
thank you. State your name first, please.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Nancy Fernandez. I am a resident in the district. Sorry, I'm not really prepared to speak today as I have a family medical condition over the last 2 days, but I just wanted to be here as a concerned parent. And the current zoning I see is going to be the kids from this current zoning is going to be assigned to Midway Elementary. Midway Elementary is nearly a 50 plus old school, and it is nowhere near to taking all the new kids that are going to be coming. Currently, the number of kids the school can take, or the capacity of the school, is 685. But as per the zoning today, I mean, as per the attendance today, it is 789. And this number will change after the redistricting we had this past fall. Giving an approval to the zoning, I have no condition, that, but only respect would request that a condition be put in the zoning to say that for any homeowner or prospective buyer need to know that kids from this
zoning would be assigned to Midway Elementary, which is already overcrowded. I moved to Forsyth County 6 years ago and was told that there was going to be a new school, and my son was just 2 years old then. Today, my son is subjected to go to Midway Elementary, which is so overcrowded. Kids start having lunch at 10:30 in the morning, and they are going to be in school until 3 o'clock. Besides that, there are many other burdens the school has to go through because of overcrowding. And I'm told that the school cannot reject any student coming from the school. So I would only request that a condition be put to the zoning saying that any kids from this new subdivision would be assigned to Midway Elementary, which is already an overcrowded school. And not necessarily will have the same, I don't want to say the level of education, because I know the teachers and the principal are doing the level best to provide the service to the student, but with the number of students per class, it is just not a fair situation for the teacher, the principal, and the school in general. Thank you, Ms. Fernando.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing for 1202 Holdings LLC, ZA3668. May I have a second?
Second.
Oh, I'm sorry. We may have to take it all back. Is there any rebuttal?
Draw a second.
You can simply vote against the motion if you don't wish to close the public hearing. It's up to you. There was a motion and I heard a second, although the second was announced, perhaps I misheard.
All those in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hands. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Does the board have any questions?
I have one.
You have one of who?
Yes, Commissioner Hoyt. Jay Lang.
Thank you. I am looking at the map that we have in the book here, and it shows...
Commissioner, can we go with the microphone?
Yes. I'm looking at the plan that was submitted February 21st, and it shows a floodplain line at the area that I'll call, for want of a better word, the southwest appendage. You know where I'm talking?
Sure.
And it looks like at least one, two, maybe three of those may not be buildable because of the floodplain line. And there's another one up about two-thirds of the way up. If I can read the fine print, it might be lot 120. You're showing lots drawn there, but you've got floodplain lines. What are your thoughts about
that? Well, number one, of course, we can't build any kind of state waters, and that's a state department, county department. So when final engineering is done, that's the reality of the situation on the ground. I will tell you, having been there a long time, and I believe most of that floodplain information is aerial run, not field run. It actually shows a portion of my house, a portion of another house I have on the property that sit up probably 20 feet above creeks in the floodplain area. They're simply incorrect. The maps are just not correct. When they start getting into areas where it's heavily tree and they're shooting aerial topography, it's just not accurate. And a couple of feet can make a big difference in the floodplain area and where they're locating it. That's really the answer.
So is this something you anticipate will be dealt with when you're getting your land disturbance permit?
That's correct. When we do our final engineering and engineer the plan itself, they'll have to do field elevation, field run. If the floodplain map is incorrect, we get it amended, we have to get it changed. There's a specific process for that. I had to go through that with my mortgage, right? Explain to them why when they change the map, all of a sudden they drew a line through the middle of my house.
Thank you, Mr. Lynn. Any more questions? Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Dolezal, this is District 3. Are you prepared to make a motion for recommendation?
I am. I'd like to, I may just thank Jay and Paul for the work getting into a place that I think is good. Commissioner Levitt spent a lot of time on this as well, so I'd probably thank him. And I would like to make a motion to send ZA 3668, 1202 Holdings LLC, to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation to approve with conditions as shown on the screen that shows here. I'd like to have a few of those. The density has been changed, resulting in a density of 1.95 units per acre, no more than 279 homes. The minimum square footage of the houses are 2,500 feet, 40% will have a minimum square footage of 3,000 feet. The average lot size should be no less, of all lots, should be no less than 12,500 square feet. 25% of the homes will have a side entry garage. The open space in the development should be no less than 23%. And the development should contain minimum active community space of 9 acres that will be maintained by the HOA. Each lot will have a minimum of 4-inch caliber tree planted in the front yard. And also I can point out that this is in the McFarland Overlay District and there are UDC requirements on top of the general requirements. And those speak to berms, planted within the berms, etc.
Commissioner Dolezal, can I ask you, I didn't know if you wanted to include staff conditions as part of your motion or not?
We have those are covered up. I do not want to include them because they're included on the document here.
Thank you.
Some of those have been updated working with engineering up until about an hour before we know.
Excuse me, but condition number 15, it refers to a 4-foot high beam.
Yeah, I've noticed that as well. Berm. We need to amend that to berm and I'll go ahead and do that.
So these conditions were agreed upon with the applicant after the 520.
That's correct.
Condition.
That's correct.
Agreement as mentioned in the conditions has not been approved by the Board of Commissioners. It's still in negotiation.
That's correct. I believe it was proposed by our engineering department. Is that correct?
That is correct. It's not finalized yet. It's still, we feel like it's real close and it'll happen before the Board of Commissioners.
Is it something we can put in our zoning conditions since it's the Board of Commissioners determination what agreements to enter into?
I look at that as a situation where if there is such an agreement in place that has not been executed at the time, this would be a condition on the property to, whether it's absolutely necessary. I mean, if there's an agreement in place, the agreement would have to be complied with as well, but it will be on top of that.
Department of Engineering feels very strongly that everything will be worked out before, but the conditions can be tweaked at the time of Board of Commissioners meeting if it hadn't been finalized at that point.
So then could we say as part of any right-of-way exchange in a swap agreement, could we say as part of any right-of-way exchange in a swap agreement so that if there is one, it would be included, but we're not trying to bind the county?
Currently, we are comfortable with as the language as it states now, and should there be any delay in the agreements, then we'll tweak the conditions before the board approves it. But we're very confident now and comfortable with what's said now, as currently stated.
Can you show me the conditions up above the 16 again? Just maybe.
Question for engineering, just on, I mean, it's not that uncommon to see it, but it says that the sewer access must be provided to all upstream properties. That would include any subdivided property that's adjacent, but the intent is to any properties that are undeveloped.
Well, I can't speak for the Department of Water and Sewer, but their standard requirement is that properties upstream will have a tie-in point for any future development, and even the existing properties, as they want to so choose to convert from septic to sewer, so that they have a requirement that the sewer go, alcohol go to the upstream side of the property.
And can I see the conditions up above 14 now? Yeah. Thank you. And now we go from 14 to 16, right?
Yeah, the
numbering is a little larger.
So the second page should start with 17.
The trees were added, those were not in the conditions from?
That's correct. We did add a tree per yard. If you would all show the greenscape, you can see those marked in the greenscape, and we actually put it in as a condition. It was their intent to have that in there. Anyway, part of what we did here, Madam Chairman, is we conditioned a lot of this community, what the intent of the community is, so that when if something were happening and somebody else comes in, we would maintain the intended use by these two gentlemen.
And the
the open space has been changed from 6 acres to 9 acres?
That's correct. We added a condition for the open space to be at 23%, which is about 50% more than the UDC requires. And due to the reduction of density here, the applicant has stated that rather than prevent lot size, keeping with the feel of their community, they'd like to put that into the open space in the parks.
Madam Chairman, we've gotten kind of a long ways down into discussion. It seems we didn't technically get a second on this yet. For formal purposes, I'd like to get a second before we do too much more discussion about the motion. So.
I'm sorry, I thought we had a second.
I'll second for discussion.
Thank you.
Commissioner Neal seconded for discussion.
Now that we're in discussion, I would like to state I've contacted the Board of Education member today. Their intention is to have Brandywine Elementary open for the 2016 school year. They already own the land. It is quote-unquote shovel-ready, and funding has been already committed by the state. So we don't know if this will go into Midway or Brandywine. Brandywine will alleviate a lot of the pressure that is at Midway. In addition to that, Mullinax Road is being widened to 4 lanes. The anticipated finish date for that is also sometime in 2016. So we were, living here and driving this route every day, my main two concerns were schools and traffic, and the county is taking steps to address that. My other concern, that we worked with these guys on, was the lot size and the overall density. And we got to a point being very comfortable with 9 acres of parks. 9 acres is approximately 360,000 square feet. So they could have taken this and dumped another 1,500 square feet into each lot. But the vision of this is to do something that's more of an active use community, and they believe that park space will contribute to that. So that's kind of how we landed at these 9 acres and 23% of the average lot size.
And you changed the site plan, because shall contain a, the one on from the 20th is a minimum of 70%. Total number of lots at 70 to 92. Was what it was before, and you've changed it from 70 to 78 and 20% 79 or greater?
Right, because we didn't want to get into it. There was a 79 to 92. They have these 92-foot lots. We didn't want to have a 95-foot lot, as an example, and have it not count in that 20% number. They did, at one point, I believe they're actually asking for a variance on this to put a 60-foot lot, and the variance is no longer being requested, and this is the lot width that they're, that they have agreed to.
And you went from 297 units to 279 units?
That's correct.
Is that because you changed the density from 2.1 to 1.95?
Yeah, that is correct. That was an agreement with the applicant to adjust the density to 1.95.
So that was an agreed upon?
Everything in this document has been agreed upon with the applicant.
Okay.
Do you, does this still have a variance in it? The original application has an exterior yard variance.
There are no variances.
Are they out now?
There are no variances associated with this.
Thank you.
That has been agreed upon by the applicant.
Amend the motion to delete condition number 4. May I have a second? That motion fails for lack of a second. We have a motion and a second on the table. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Bowman being opposed. Ridgeline Land Planning Incorporated, CA-3671, has been withdrawn by the applicant without prejudice. Lenora Georgia Incorporated, CA-3674. Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A-1 to Single Family Residential District Res 3 on 31.77 acres for the development of 55 residential lots with a density of 1.73 units per acre. There is a variance request to reduce the required exterior yard setback to 25 feet for a portion of lot 62 per UDC Chapter 11-4.3, Table 11.2B. This property is located at 4827, 4931, 4951, and 4953 Bethelview Road, Cumming, Georgia, 30040. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for Lenora Georgia Incorporated, CA-3674. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of CA-3674 Lenora Georgia Incorporated?
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, John Scott, Wilson Johnson. I have the pleasure of being here before you again tonight on behalf of Lenora Georgia Inc. Here with me tonight are Lenora's Division President, Todd Jones, and also Jim Bowersox, the Vice President in charge of Land Acquisition for Lenora. As Ms. Goldman said, we're here tonight seeking a recommendation of approval to this board for Lenora's Res 3 rezoning application. This property, the entire parcel is being acquired by Lenora, consists of approximately 45 acres, as you can see outlined in red, located on Bethelview Road. It's just to the south of Silver Lake Subdivision and just to the north of Coventry and across the street from the polling fields. The property that's the subject of the rezoning application before you tonight is outlined in yellow. As you can see, that does not exactly match up with the property that Lenora is acquiring, and that is because approximately 13.5 acres of this property is already zoned Res 3. It was rezoned back in 2007 under CA-3379. Lenora proposes to combine, and that's actually the property outlined in red there that's already zoned. Lenora is proposing to combine all these properties into one project in order to develop one subdivision with one access entrance up across the street from the park side of the Polo Field subdivision, which is the gated senior community across Bethelview Road. As Ms. Goldman stated, the application before you tonight on the 33-acre parcel that is subject to rezoning is asking for approval of up to 55 lots and a density of 1.73 units an acre. Again, we will have one entrance on Bethelview Road. I know there was some confusion about planning on the second entrance. Looking at this project as one comprehensive development, we're looking at a density of 1.84 units per acre, I'm sorry, 1.83 units per acre, with 83 total homes on 45 acres. So if you add the existing Res 3 together with the A1 parcel that's before you tonight, this is what you have. Now, the main benefit of Lenora's proposal is that Lenora will now have control over the existing Res 3 zoning, which was approved for 9,000 square foot lots, and it was approved for 2,100 square foot houses. Lenora has agreed to increase that minimum lot size on that adjacent zoning from 9,000 square feet up to 10,000 minimum, with a 13,000 square foot average over the entire development. They've also agreed to increase those home sizes from 2,100 square feet to 2,600 square feet. And again, this is on the property that's not subject to the zoning, but it's already zoned. So Lennar's actually bringing that in and increasing those standards in order to harmonize this with the properties before you this evening. We are seeking one variance to a portion of lot 62. The reason this variance is needed, you can see lot 62 highlighted there in red, is because that triangular piece to the south, which is an M1 zone, I believe it's a construction roofing business, causes a bottleneck effect, causing Lennar to have to wrap that street around that property. And what it does is it shrinks the building envelope on lot 62 significantly. So in order to build a house that's going to be comparable in size and price to the rest of them, we have sought relief to reduce the exterior setback to 25 feet on that portion of lot 62. We have met out on this property with the residents who live in Oak Knoll subdivision, including the ones who back up to this affected lot. And we've agreed to impose a condition requiring Lennar to build a 6-foot-tall wooden privacy fence and landscape that entire area pursuant to a landscape plan that's sent to the neighbors. So, to summarize what Lennar has offered up on this particular project, again, the installation of the privacy fencing and the landscaping for Oak Knoll, increasing the minimum lot size on that adjacent zone to 10,000 square feet, imposing 13,000 average throughout the entire project, 2,600 square foot minimum house size, and at least half of the homes in the subdivision have to be developed on the basements. We're installing an active amenity area that's consisting of a swimming pool and a cabana at minimum. And we're also increasing the landscaping along Bethelview Road. Finally, and most importantly, Lennar has also agreed to make all the homes in this neighborhood three-sided brick or stone with accents not to exceed 25%, which is the standard. And we've also agreed to narrow the overlap on siding. So typically what you see is an 8-inch lap when you have siding stacked to cut the side of the house. We've agreed to shrink that, which not only increases the cost of the house, but it gives it a more unique looking feel. So these are all the things, again, that Lennar is willing to do to put its stamp on this project. Your staff is supportive. The project does conform to the future development map and a comprehensive plan. So with that, I would ask for your support. Thank you for your time and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Lennar Georgia Incorporated, ZA3674. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Is there any discussion on closing the public hearing? All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Does the board have any questions? No? Commissioner Dahlonega, this is District 3. Are you prepared to make a motion?
Yes, Madam Chairman. I have a motion. I'd like to make a motion to send ZA3674, Lennar Georgia Inc., to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation to approve as res 3 with conditions as shown on the screen, which we'll agree upon.
These are agreed upon conditions as well?
That is correct.
And I just want to be clear, because I see the first additional condition is actually approval of the variance or approval of a variance.
I need to state that as part of my motion. I would like to withdraw my motion and restate it to send, let me see, can you scroll that up so I get that number for a second, please? I move the ZA3674 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation to approve with variance as stated on the screen as res 3.
I
Before we go further with it, I just want to make clear that the conditions, particularly I'm looking, I know number three, it's on the screen right now, and number five, any of the, number six, I see, any of the conditions that reference the property that was the subject of ZA 3379, these conditions will not apply to that property, meaning that we can't enforce what happens on that property. This variance only applies to the property that is the subject of this action, ZA 3674. That being said, you can use it as a reference for what happens on this property in the sense of 50% of all lots included in those. Now, it, you know, whoever winds up doing something on property ZA 3379 may, you know, take, if they don't wind up being the same person, if I don't know the title status, if they are actually the same owner, that makes it easy. If somehow that gets split or they never come together, that may create a burden on this 3674 property. I'm just making sure that's clear, and I'll be happy to answer your questions if that was not perfectly clear.
Suggesting if he wanted to include it all, that he should mention both ZA numbers and that these conditions will apply to both ZA numbers?
No, what I'm saying is that these conditions will not attach to the ZA 3379 property, so that any development of that property is subject to the existing conditions as of today. We're not changing those conditions. They may stipulate that they will incorporate a project that involves that property, but will only be able to enforce these conditions on 3674, the one that's subject to this rezoning and variance tonight. Now, that being said, I believe some of the conditions may reference a certain number of lots in the total project. That would apply to 3674. So if 3379 uses up all of those basement lots, or doesn't do any basement lots, then the 3674 property, tonight's property, maybe they have their hands tied on what they can do.
Is it possible for you to withdraw my motion and ask a question and go back to discussion?
I think so, because I don't know if we had a second.
I'd like to withdraw my motion and ask Mr. Scoggins the title status of each of these properties.
The properties are currently owned by individual owners. They are under contract by the owner to be purchased. One thing I do want to point out, Mr. Fricke, I apologize. I did not say during my presentation that ZA 3379 is the subject of a zoning condition amendment application that's coming before the board at the June 5th meeting. At that meeting, we will agree to impose these conditions that will change the conditions on ZA 3379. He is correct. These conditions will not bind that zoning, but as is always the case when we have all these parcels, everything's moving in, you know, multiple stages. So we are addressing that, and we will address that with Commissioner Levin at the board level.
Thank you. I was aware of that. I probably should have pointed that out previously. I'd like to make a motion to send ZA 3674 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation to approve as res 3 with the variance as with conditions as shown on the screen.
Second.
We're in discussion now, is that correct, Madam Chair?
Yes, we have a motion and a second.
So what the applicant and I discussed in conversations about this was exactly what he said. This, that they were, before this gets voted on by the Board of Commissioners, we will have a vote on a zoning amendment that will be in the same spirit as this agreement. That's why we're making this recommendation as it's shown.
So you're satisfied in leaving your conditions as they are, even though they reference the 79?
Yes, ma'am.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Next is Rivington Glen Investments, LLC, ZA3678. Ms. Goldman.
As stated at the beginning of the meeting, there will be an additional public hearing held on June 19, 2014 before the Board of Commissioners to consider this proposal request as well as a variance to allow the exterior setback on lots 1 and 15 to be 20 feet. This evening, the public hearing request does not include a variance. The request is to rezone from Agricultural District A1 and Single Family Residential Restricted District R2R to Single Family Residential District Res 3 on 8.09 acres for 15 residential lots with a density of 1.85 units per acre. This property is located at 3959 Drew Campground Road, Cumming, Georgia, 30040. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for Rivington Glen Investments, LLC, ZA3678. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Dolezal. Is there any discussion? All in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of Rivington Glen Investments, LLC? ZA3678.
Madam Chairman, I'm Emmer Lips, and I'm here on behalf of Rivington Glen Investment. Rivington Glen is comprised of David Frost and Mark Frost, and they are the builders. And they built 14 homes in the preserve at Fieldstone, which this property is adjacent to. They have some very satisfied customers who bought the homes from them there. Their sister lives in one of those homes there in the preserve. And what they wish to do is to continue the level of quality of the preserve at Fieldstone, the homes that they built there, and build 15 homes on this 8.088 acre tract that will be equal to or perhaps even nicer than the homes at the preserve of Fieldstone. They have agreed to form their own HOA for this property. It will not be a part of the preserve at Fieldstone, will not be annexed into preserve at Fieldstone. And this may be gated. And the board, as you know, the Board of Commissioners will have to approve whether this can be gated or not. But you know, that would, I think, give even more upscale effect to the plans that the Frost have for this property. All of the lots will meet the Res 2 minimum lot sizes, and the homes will be 3,000 square feet and larger. There will be no entrance from Drew Campground Road. Rather, there will be an entrance from Winterberry Road, which enters Drew Campground at a location that has excellent sight distance and has a signal there. So it will be a safe entrance for these 15 homes. I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Lipscomb. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition?
Did you fill your form out, sir?
I did.
And if you'll state your name first when you come up, that would be great.
My name is Hope Cloud. I'm a private property owner, but I'm next to this development. And really the only concern that I have, there is a detention pond that is on the front piece of my property. I am at a low point there. I just want to ensure that water is not going to be drained through my front yard and, you know, through my property. I've kind of got a hand-dug ditch that I'll channel that down. And instead of not hosing property, I just want to ensure that the detention pond is not going to drain across the road. And that there will be some type of landscaping, that type of thing planted, you know, so that I have to look at this big wall. Whatever, that's all I have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in opposition? Mr. Lipscomb, can you answer them? Questions for Mr. Cloud?
Rather than me stumbling around, whether I get somebody here that can answer. This is David
Cross. The retention pond that he speaks of, it will not drain on his property. We've actually asked for a easement to cut through where the drive is going and ties into the reserve hillstone. There's actually a drop down up there. We're asking to tie into this. So that basically all of our water, all the, if you're looking at the plants on that one side of this road, so has all the water back in this one section drives, can carries down to the retention pond and then carries over into the storm.
There's a buffer there, right?
The drain on there is actually shown in a black line. You're looking at the site plan from the bottom left. The drain's to the far right.
Assume you wouldn't
On the original, the open space, that was with me in rest three.
Gotcha.
And moved into rest two, open space, that was well.
So along lots 1 through 5?
Yes.
What would be your plan for the rear of those landscaping-wise? When you mentioned that you have a budget for that.
Yeah, and there is a considerable number of nice trees back there. Of course, we want to save the case. And as far as where the retention pond goes, of course, we'll move from there. But we do intend to, like I said, fence the retention pond and for protection, but then also the landscape around it. And in the past, we've used evergreens, magnolia trees, leylands, for the various plants.
I'm sorry, sir, you, Mr. Cloud Gardner, let me try to find your exact parcel, the gentleman that spoke in opposition.
Mr. Cloud?
It's Cloud. Yes, sir. You actually answered my question for me just by stating your name. I was trying to identify your parcel.
I'm a parcel of property, I guess, directly behind the retention pond. Are you looking at the wrong?
Yeah, I see it here now. So I just was unclear. I didn't catch your name when you stated earlier.
Yeah, he just needed your name as I'm needed. He's all right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Commissioner Dahlonega, this is District 3. Are you prepared to make a motion for a recommendation?
I am, Madam Chair. I would like to move to send ZA 3678, Revington Glen Investments LLC, to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation to approve as a Res 2. With, of course, an 18,500 square foot minimum lot size per the Res 2 with conditions as shown on the screen.
Once again, it appears number 8 there is a variance as opposed to a condition.
I would draw my motion and remake a motion to send ZA 3678 to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation to approve as Res 2 with a variance as stated in the conditions and conditions as shown on the screen.
Before we go any further, I don't believe a variance was advertised.
That is why the public hearing will happen next month.
Oh, that's correct. Therefore, it should not be part of this. It should not be part of this board's consideration tonight.
Okay, I'd like to withdraw the motion.
Withdraw the second?
Yes.
Commissioner Hoyt has withdrawn his second.
I'd like to make a motion to send ZA 3678 to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation to approve as Res 2 with conditions as shown on the screen.
Second for discussion.
Madam Chair, if we're in discussion, I'd like to state that these, what you're seeing on the screen are the architectural designs that were part of the Lennar, I'm sorry, part of the previous Fieldstone Preserve development, and they want to build homes in that same spirit, so they have attached these as a reference, as reference to the zoning commission.
Are these all agreed upon with the applicant as well?
Yes, Madam Chair, everything, both of these documents have been agreed upon with the applicant.
There's a reference to an architectural review committee, it appears throughout these. Is there a condition to establish an architectural review committee, or how?
That, I believe, would be established in their HOA, they're certainly welcome if we feel it appropriate to make a motion to amend this.
Yeah, I was just trying to figure out how to, I don't know if it's been discussed with staff, but just how staff would enforce something that's approved by an architectural review committee. Like, once it gets into that, we want staff to be the architectural review committee in zoning, which would greatly increase what they're inspecting, but then, how does it get enforced if it's by a committee in the neighborhood just making decisions, I guess?
Staff would need to know who to reach out to in order, when it refers to a representative of a committee, we would need to have information about that committee in order to enforce the condition.
Can we, in effect, delegate to a private architectural review committee the power to make changes in these conditions where they are conditions, as opposed to some minor architectural standards, some of which may be a matter of taste? We need to include those in our zoning condition recommendations.
You cannot establish, if the zoning condition is just approval, that's not necessarily, if you're saying that they can set what any conditions, any additional conditions of the property, that would be a different kind of statement. I think these read that.
Can you go back to the conditions, not the architectural review?
Just the main conditions.
The second page, I think, is where this.
Yeah, I mean. Yeah, I have a question.
Is there a point where this changes from applicant proposed conditions to the architectural review?
Yes.
Portion.
Yes.
Where is it? It's after 14.
Okay, so is there a condition within? I haven't seen within these 14 conditions that states anything about the architectural review.
There is.
Where does that come into play?
I think normally it gets created when the HOA gets created.
No, what I'm saying is, it in these conditions?
It is.
It's only condition number 10.
Correct.
Talks about the design standard.
Thank you.
I guess what I'm trying to look at this situation, I'm trying to figure out is, say that the architectural review committee did not approve something where they have the power to approve, if it was ordained by this code, the architectural review committee wouldn't have the authority to change it, and then how would the appeal, is there again a county appeals process to remove that condition?
Well, there's certainly a process for removing zoning condition amendment. I feel like if you want certain standards, it is your prerogative and province to establish those standards. If you want to leave it to someone else, then leave it to them, and it wouldn't really need to be a zoning condition.
What I would like to propose to the board is that we withdraw this, strike the references to the architectural review committee. Basically, what the applicant was wanting to do was build these homes in the spirit of the preserve fieldstone community. If we remove the references to the architectural review, it will still have minimum square footage at all homes, shall be minimum 3,000 square feet, which are heated and cooled, all basin wall construction, loaded by soil, shall be poured concrete, no concrete block, etc. Basically, what I would propose we do is strike the references to the architectural review committee altogether. Then in condition 10, agree all homes shall have exterior finishes as shown on the attached design standards, and then those attached design standards would have no reference to the architectural review committee.
Man, I understand that the developer intends to adhere to these, and he would like to implement these. And so, you know, I have no concerns about that. I'm just trying to figure out how we would enforce them. And I was just wondering if there's not a way that
we would take out the need to enforce them based on the architectural review committee. We would just basically be saying similar to what we have conditioned
right.
in all the other zonings of 15% this, 20% that, as such, as depicted in the design standards. Is that correct?
I mean, that still means that if there's an issue, then the inspectors, when they're trying to approve these buildings, are going to have to go through something. Like, if it's just a percentage, that's one thing, but how much more comprehensive is it? Like, do they have to recognize certain architectural styles and architectural elements that maybe they aren't?
Councilor, do I need Mr. Hoyt to withdraw his second prior to me without a motion? Can I do that?
I'll withdraw it before you withdraw the motion.
Thank you, sir. Let's try this again.
But before you make a motion, can I ask a question on these conditions or do I need to wait?
They're not yet on the table, I don't think. So, if I may make a motion, I would like to make a motion to send ZA-3678 to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation to approve as res to the conditions as shown on the screen.
Second for discussion.
Sorry.
I have a question about condition number 12. It talks about payment $7,500 to the reserve HOA to be held in escrow under control of the HOA. I assume that's the preserve HOA. But then it says, until control of the HOA is turned over to the homeowners and the preserve of Fieldstone.
That's correct, Commissioner, if I can explain that.
But it sounds like this was two different developments. In other words, this one and Fieldstone next door. And if Fieldstone next door has already been turned over to its association.
It has not, and that's why this is, there's currently a declarant in this building in there. And there's a history here of the developers spending the funds in the HOA because they're a declarant. They can basically, they are a one person majority. And the intent of this is to offset some of the HOA's expense, given the ability to do additional landscaping, should they choose to do that, in deference to the fact that they're giving interest to this community, to this new community. The applicant has agreed to do that, and collectively, the applicant and the homeowners and the association believe that this provides them some protection that the current declare will not spend in a way that is not under the spirit of the agreement they have.
So then, the intent is, as you understand it, once the preserve and fieldstone declarant turns over control to its HOA, not anything with this applicant, then that money would go. So it's irrevocably gone from the applicant's development. Is that right?
That's correct.
Even though this development will not be annexed into?
That is correct. The applicant has agreed to make this payment to be preserved for itself, HOA.
Because they're going through that subdivision as their entrance.
Correct.
Can I see the rest of the conditions, Ms. Feldman? I'm sorry.
I have a question. Are we now getting into collecting homeowner fees? And is that something that we have the staff to be able to do? I mean, I've never seen a condition about a homeowner fee. Council?
Well, this is not necessarily a homeowner fee. It's payment related. I don't know what it is specifically tied to. I have not particularly seen this. If it can be, if the condition is sufficiently tied to alleviate the burden of this zoning, I'd be more comfortable with it. If it's just a blanket payment, it may create issues of contract zoning.
There were concerns expressed by there's one entrance in and out of this community. It's a large community. There was concern about whether this particular development should come off of Kelly Mill or should come to preserve a fieldstone. And in part of the back and forth conversation, this was something that was, I believe, actually proposed by the applicant to the HOA. I should say the preserve fieldstone.
I guess the question, how does that mitigate something? I mean, what is the money going to be spent on? Is it going to be spent to mitigate that, or is it spent? Is it kind of like either you can pay somebody money to?
Not at those.
We have a motion and a second. Is that correct? We have a motion and a second. Or a discussion? I'd like to make an amendment. I make a motion to strike condition number 12, to delete condition number 12.
Second.
We have an amendment motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the amendment, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion for the amendment passes 4-1 with Commissioner Dellazal being opposed. So now we're back to the main motion. Is there more discussion?
My only discussion would be if they want to make the payment, if they want to work it out with the declarant or whoever, they can, but I didn't think that we needed to be managing that.
We're back to the main motion. All those in favor of the amended main motion, please. I'm sorry.
I still had a couple other questions. I need to see the other sheet again. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
That's okay. Actually, the next one. I guess I had a question on Amendment 9 about brick and mortar samples and brick being standard to queen size, whether we have staff that could that would have the capacity to analyze that. And if so, what are they analyzing it for? Because, you know, submitting samples to the county probably can't make a call on what's suitable or unsuitable there.
Right now, just be whether it's standard or queen size. I don't know. They can probably do that without seeing the exact sample, but this requirement.
As long as those sizes are standardized by the industry, staff could certainly make that determination.
You would need samples, though. Because it says that samples would be submitted with plans, but you wouldn't want a plan with samples.
We do receive sample boards for construction projects currently, not typically for commercial projects and projects within overlay districts.
Any more discussion?
Can you go to the original page, the very first page? I don't know which one.
I don't know which one's in it.
We'd like to make a motion to amend.
All right, so in light of the confusion, I'd like to make a motion to amend the current motion to change to strike 10, condition number 10, from this motion, leaving all others as is, but just striking 10.
We have a motion to amend and a second. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of this amended motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. And that takes care of all of it. Yes. Now we're back to the main motion. The amended main motion. All those in favor, did you have anything up to me or did that take care of it? All in favor of the amended main motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. I would not want to do the work of the minutes. Tonight. Just saying. Okay, now we're up to E. Howard Carson Jr., ZA3679. Commissioner Hoyt?
Yes, I have an announcement due to business relationships with Orchards Group. I am recusing myself from any involvement in this and will step down.
It's my understanding that you can stay in the room, you can just sit in the audience.
I don't know what else to call it, but an audience.
Esteemed guests.
What?
Our esteemed guests.
Esteemed guests. It just sounded funny when I said audience. Ms. Goldman.
This is a request to rezone from Agricultural District A1 to Multifamily Residential District Res 6 on 36.90 acres for 77 attached residential units and 12 residential lots with a density of 2.41 units per acre. This property is located on the north side of Atlanta Highway, Georgia 9, approximately 1,000 feet west of the intersection with Castleberry Road. Staff is non-supportive.
Thank you, Ms. Goldman. I make a motion to open the public hearing for E. Howard Carson Jr., ZA3679. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 4-0 with Commissioner Boyd.
I didn't even get my hair done.
Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of E. Howard Carson Jr., ZA3679?
Yes, Madam Chair, my name is Howard Carson, 3082 East Shelonet Avenue, Atlanta. Thank you for hearing me tonight. What I have before you is a Res 6 zoning for the 5th Orchards Development in Forsyth County. They are a longtime and widely esteemed active adult builder. This project will consist of 89 active adult, age-restricted units. 77 of those will be attached, and there will be 12 single-family lots in the project. As you can see from the site plan, almost half of the property is floodplain. The entirety of that floodplain will be preserved as open space with minor adjustments of some floodplain swapping so that the amenity site can be built on the east side of the road and so that the subdivision can have a community garden as we've asked for that condition. I'd like to show you some things around. Mrs. Bernstein, can you put that PDF up on the screen? There you go. As you can see from this board and anyone else can see from the screen, this property is surrounded by intense uses. Immediately, here is the property with the layout of the subdivision shown. The property immediately to the west of it is zoned for 101,300 square feet of retail space and 514 parking spaces. That was done under a PUD zoning. The property that was also done as a, the northern part of that property that was done under that same PUD was zoned for a single family residential product at a 2.99 unit per acre density. The property immediately west of that was zoned as a Res 6 non-age restricted development and is now developed in part townhomes and part very, very tight zero lot line homes. The property across the street is zoned O&I for a 21,000 square foot office building and retail use. The property across Highway 9 here is zoned Res 4. That zoning did allow for attached units. It was not built that way, but it did at the time allow attached units. This property is totally surrounded by intense commercial and residential uses. It is the right zoning for this property because it is age restricted, and those 55 and older residents of Forsyth County do not consume the same services that families do. Want to get into that. One of Commissioner Dahlonega's big concerns is traffic. It's a big concern for all of us. It's hard for me to get around the county, much less people who live here. I have sent staff and several of y'all a traffic study that proves that this residential zone that has a Res 6 has 50% of the traffic impact of a standard Res 3 zoning of the same property. You've got that from ANR Engineering, a very widely acclaimed traffic engineer. That is 50% of the traffic impact of a standard Res 3 zoning, which would comply with the land use plan. Furthermore, this development will send no children to Forsyth County schools. As some of you may remember, I was involved with and sold the land to the Orchards Group for the orchards at Brandon Oak. That is a 218 unit development that is exactly like this, just three times as big, two and a half times as big. There is not one single school child that comes from the orchards at Brandon Oak. Tim Amerson is out in the crowd. He confirmed that for us just 3 or 4 months ago when we zoned the Stony Point piece. There's not one child in the orchards that ran out of the coast for Forsyth County School. This project has traffic, much, much reduced traffic impact on Forsyth County, and has those kids going to the school. The residents vote, they pay their taxes, they shop in Forsyth County, they go to doctors in Forsyth County. They consume county services, but just not the ones that are being stressed right now. I had a public information meeting. I had a total of 3 people show up at that public information meeting. 2 of those were interested buyers. They came because they wanted the first unit in the development. Both Commissioners Iglesias and Dahlonega were at that same meeting. I've met with all of the surrounding property owners that I have been able to get in touch with. I'm not aware of any opposition, but I will use the
remainder of my time to rebut any opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Carson. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing for E. Howard Carson, Jr., ZA3679. May I have a second?
Seconded.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion to close the public hearing passes 4-0 with Commissioner Hoyt being recused. Does the board have any questions?
Madam Chair, I have a few questions for Mr. Carson. Mr. Carson, you referenced floodplain swap. That's something I'm not familiar with. You mind indulging me the logistics of how that happened?
Do you have an aerial photo of the property, Vanessa, or can you put our site plan up? Sorry to ambush you with that, Vanessa.
Mr. Carson.
Floodplain swap. If you remember that property, the vast majority of the property that needs to be developed is a big pasture. There is a little bit of the property on the right-hand side of the entrance, because the entrance will align with Fowler Road. There is a small portion of the property to the right of the entrance, or on the east side of the entrance, that is actually in the floodplain, as set by FEMA. We will fill in a quantity of soil into the floodplain in order to allow that road to be built and the amenities to be built. And it's just a small area. Fill in an area, and then we'll take the exact same quantity of dirt out of the floodplain so that our net effect on that floodplain is zero.
Great. Do a few more questions if you want.
Sure.
The traffic study that you referenced, are you aware what spec they use for res 3, density spec, and or lot size?
That's
kind of been all over the map for the county.
I have talked this through my land planner. It would be a very simple thing to lay this out as a standard res 3 which you could apply for. We laid that out for 43 lots. If you did a strict res 3 with a 2.5 density under the requirements, that would be many more lots than this traffic study that I sent to you. I asked my traffic engineer to do that, comparing it to 43 residential lots, which is a 1.1 density, 1.2 density. So,
and how many did you say you could fit on the parcel as it is?
It would be very easy for us to fit 43 res 3 lots. I believe it would be fairly easy for us to fit 50 res 3 as the standards exist today. I think very easy for us to develop that property in 50 rest of the lots. So I could have made the traffic study comparison look much more drastic than what you're looking at now. I just asked him to do it as 43 because I thought that was reasonable.
Right. Relative to your comment about zero children in schools, has there been, I haven't seen all of your proposed conditions, but has there been a condition that would make that a reality as opposed to kind of hoping that that is a reality?
You mean about restricting against kids?
Mm-hmm.
I will defer to attorneys as to whether that would be legally enforceable. Commissioner Dolezal, there are conditions of distress in families where daughter gets divorced, needs a home, abusive husband, whatever that circumstance is, and a daughter has to come back and live with mom and dad for a period of time. I don't think it would be right to keep that from happening. I think that it would be reasonable to look back at the other orchards developments. I've been involved, this is now my fourth development that I've been involved with for them. I never have seen a school bus pull up in front of an orchards development, unless it maybe was a senior citizen plus.
Thank you. I do have one last question. On these quadruplexes and single family homes, is your plan for all of them to have 2-car garages?
I believe that's correct. That is correct.
Thank you.
Sure.
Any more questions? Thank you, Mr. Carson.
Thank you.
Commissioner Delazal, this is District 3. Are you prepared to make a motion?
Yes, Madam Chair. I would like to make a motion to send ZA 3679, E. Howard Carson Jr. to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation of denial.
Is there a second? That motion fails for lack of a second. Make a motion that we send ZA 3679 E. Howard Carson Jr. to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with staff conditions in our books, both water, sewer, and recommended engineering conditions. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion?
Madam Chair, I'd like to add a motion to add a condition that the proposed development should be age restricted to property owners and residents 55 and older to the extent allowable under existing federal, state, and local laws, rules, regulations, and ordinances.
That is part of the application.
Okay. I don't know if that needed to be. I've seen it in previous orchards conditions. I don't know why that would be. But if that's.
It's
in the application.
Then
it's age restricted according to those guidelines.
Correct.
So, are you withdrawing what you?
I will withdraw the motion, Madam Chair.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Before you mentioned just staff conditions and not the applicant requested zoning conditions.
I believe that's what you said. Is that what you intended?
Yeah, it should include all of them, so the applicant requested conditions should be included in that. Would you like me to restate everything?
Okay, so withdraw
and restate?
Please.
Who did the second? The Commissioner Iglesias, would you withdraw your
withdrawal?
I'll withdraw my motion. Okay, I make a motion to send ZA 3679 E. Howard Carson Jr. to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with staff conditions. And applicant requested conditions. And there was no variance. And that's my motion. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 3-1 with Commissioner Dolezal being opposed and Commissioner Hoyt being recused. Commissioner Hoyt, welcome back.
This is a request to rezone from Office Residential District OR to Single Family Residential District Res 2 for one residential lot on 0.69 acres with a density of 1.44 units per acre. This property is located at 5605 Browns Bridge Road, Cumming, Georgia, 30041. Staff is supportive.
Hey.
Thank you.
Hey, Jared, how are you doing, man?
Good I make a motion. I make a motion to open the public hearing for Nolan H. Grant, ZA 3680.
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Hoy. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of Nolan H. Grant, ZA 3680? Forward, please state your name first, please, Mr.
Yes, I am Nolan Grant, and I'll be quick. We're just requesting that we reverse the rezoning that took place about 10 years ago, And at that time, it was rezoned office residential to accommodate a real estate office. And it's our intention now to use it as our family residence. And so the, our application is for the rezoned single family residence. So we appreciate your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Grant. Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing for Nolan H. Grant, ZA 3680. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Neal. Any discussion? All in favor of the motion to close the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand.
Sorry.
All right, getting anxious. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. Does the board have any questions of Mr. Grant? Nope. Commissioner Hoyt, this is District 5. Are you prepared to make a motion?
I am. I move that the Planning Commission recommend to the Board of Commissioners. I move that the Planning Commission recommend to the Board of Commissioners approval of the application ZA 3680 submitted by Nolan H. Grant from Office Residential District OR to Single Family Residential District Res 2 for one residential lot on 0.69 acres with density of 1.44 units per acre for property in District 5, tax parcel 256-105 at 5605 Browns Bridge Road. There being no variances requested.
Seconded by Commissioner Dahlonega. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0.
Mr. Grant, we're sorry that you had to wait through all of that before that.
That's fine, thank you. Appreciate it.
Pulte Home Corporation, ZA 3681, has been postponed to the June 24th, 2014 meeting. Sony Development, LLC, ZA 3682, has been postponed to June 24th, 2014. I make a motion to adjourn the May 27th, 2014 Planning Commission regular meeting. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. Discussion. All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0. The meeting is adjourned at 10:04 p.m. What was it then?
8:45. Justin, thank you so much for all your help.
Have a good day.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, take care.
Yep.
Man, I totally lost that one. Don't forget to turn your mic off.
I just told Tom, I just submit those separate questions.